annual Race and Performance Expo. My name is Jeanette DesJardins, and we're just going to dive right in. Right, you see more people own a mobile device than a toothbrush. So just so you know, I broke my cell phone last night. I do have a toothbrush. We're just fine this morning. So again, my name is Jeanette DesJardins. I'm the founder and president of Card Chix and Crinket Media. I have about 15 plus years of experience in the automotive and motorsports industry. Graduate of University of Wisconsin, Milwaukee in 2012. I was a feature speaker at the Women in Motorsports Seminar in PRI in 2016. Just some background. They didn't just find me walking down the street like, hey kid, come in here. So today we're just going to talk mostly about social media and websites. And I want to be clear that that's just a small piece of the pie when it comes to marketing. A lot of people will be like, well, you know, I made a couple posts on Facebook. My phone wasn't ringing off the hook, so marketing doesn't work for me. And that's just not true. It's just a small sliver of this huge pie called marketing. It's just a tool. So social media can be all unicorns and rainbows if used the right way. It can also be a hot mess. That is Kim Kardashian. She's a hot mess sometimes. So let's look at some bad social media. We've all seen this image some way, somehow. You know, your buddy gets wasted at a party. Let's get some markies. Let's get some Sharpies. Let's color all over him and take him to Denny's at 3 o'clock in the morning. Unfortunately for this woman, she was actually a cheerleader for the Patriots. Patriots caught wind of that. She is no longer a cheerleader. I did not see her at the Super Bowl. She lost her job. And that's because she posted this on Facebook. I find it ironic that Detroit is known as the Motor City, yet no one here knows how to drop. That was from Chrysler. Like, wow, Chrysler, tell us how you really feel this morning, right? That actually wasn't Chrysler. That was somebody that worked at the agency that Chrysler hired to run their social media page, and he thought that was going on his personal page. Whoops. That guy got fired, and I don't think Chrysler uses that agency any longer. We've all seen something like this, naked, wet, and stoned. with the picture posted on Facebook. Apparently, the school that she teaches at did not approve of that. She was let go and fired immediately. And yes, the drunken fairy photo. Who here has called into work and not been sick before? All right, you guys, I mean, be honest. You know, I'm not the HR department. I don't, you know, I'm not going to tell them. Apparently, that's what this guy did. And he posted this photo on Facebook, and his employer commented on how cool his wand looked right before he fired him. So, just some general housekeeping rules, and I always say this, the magnifying glass effect. When you post online, people are going to judge you. People are going to read in between the lines. Everything that you do is underneath a magnifying glass, and it's being analyzed way beyond what you even meant to post about it. You know, someone posts they're having a terrible day, right away people are thinking something's wrong with your relationship, something's wrong with your job, something's wrong with your car, you know, who knows. I always say, if you would not show your grandmother or your kids, you should not post it online. Another rule of thumb I always say, nothing good happens on midnight, after midnight, especially on Facebook. Unless we're still racing at Great Lakes Raceway. What you put online is public and permanent. You know, I know that there's different settings where people are like, well, you know, it's just to my friends, or Snapchat, you know, it destroys itself. There's this beautiful thing called screenshots, and if someone really wants to see what you put online, they will find it, and they will save it, and they will use it against you, they put it in a folder, whatever. So just, you know, just watch out for that. Two of the main, there's so many different social media networks, but what we're really going to focus on, because they're like two birds with one stone, is Facebook and Instagram, and that's because, in my opinion, they are star-crossed lovers. Facebook just bought Instagram not too long ago, so when you run paid ads on Facebook, you can automatically get them to go on Instagram. It's a beautiful thing. So, Facebook, like just general knowledge, conduct business on your business page. Facebook will close your account if you're using it as your personal page, as a business page. A lot of the benefits are you create ads from your business page. You can analyze the data and make better posts and better posting decisions. And make sure you complete your profile. Make sure people know that it's active and that you actually took the time to fill out the About Us, you know, the services you offer, your event page, all that good stuff. Now, I just had this conversation with somebody. You know, the best times to post online, they're like, well, the best times to post online is between 9 and 3 o'clock. And that's the biggest mistake I've ever heard people say. The best time to post online is when your followers are online. So if you have a business page, you go to Insights, you go to Posts, and you can see what times and what days are your people are online. And everybody's is a little different. There is no cookie cutter approach. This is a different page as opposed to the first one, and you can see they have different peaks of time, different days that are more beneficial. A lot of times you'll see a spike in your traffic on your Facebook page at between 8 and 9 o'clock, between 12 and 1 o'clock, and after 5. Why is that? Because people are just getting to work, they got to check all their cute cat photos in their newsfeed, then they're on the lunch break, they got to check it again, and then after 5 they're at home. Or some people, they just sit at work all day looking at all this cute stuff. So. Sorry, I have a little issue. All right, paid ads. People freak out about paid ads. All right, it's really not that scary of a thing. They're terrified of paid ads, either because they have anxiety about setting it up wrong and losing money. And you can lose money really fast if you do this the wrong way. Or they have created ads in the past and they didn't see any return and they just blew a bunch of money. Now, why is that? Did they not target it correctly? Did they not, you know, do they feel rushed? I mean, the last thing you want to do is rush through setting up a paid ad for social media accounts and you make a big mistake. 2018, welcome to pay to play. The days of organic anything have passed us a long time ago. When I first started the Facebook for Card Chicks about 8-9 years ago, all of our followers were organic. I never created an ad to try to get people to like my page, and now we have over 101,000 people on there. But nowadays, it's almost impossible for that to happen. Facebook makes money by selling ads to advertisers or advertising space. So if you're late to the game, you don't have a page, you just started a page, it's you're playing a game of catch-up right now. So let's go through the ad process. When you make ads on Facebook, you can run the same ads on Instagram with a click of a button, and you kill two birds with one stone. So before we go through the ad process, what makes a good ad? So my favorite thing to do is let's look at some bad ones first, right? Okay. Indian celebrity selfies. What are these people selling? I mean, they seriously blew a bunch of money to run this as a paid ad. I mean, does anyone know what these people are selling? They're selling exactly that. Indian celebrity selfies. Problem is, there's no headline. There's no copy, meaning a text or a description. There's no call to action, a CTA. It doesn't say buy now, shop now, book now, you know, learn more. There's no call to action. So in my opinion, it's just kind of a wasted ad. Yeah, they got a lot of likes on there, but they could have got a lot more and, you know, maybe, you know, some kind of conversion, which is ultimately what you want. So SOCA on the seas, I have no idea. I don't know if they're it's a sailing team, they play soccer, I have no idea. Again, if you're scrolling through Facebook and you're looking at cute cat photos, you're looking at Stevie Jackson's last racing video from Lights Out 9, are you really gonna stop and read this? No, you're gonna scroll right by it. Not only are you gonna scroll right by it, but it doesn't make sense. I mean, punctuation and spelling, if you leave here with one thing today, please use complete sentences, punctuation, spelling, and use some kind of attention, like rich media, like you need a photo, you need a video. Again, call to action. One of the things that's kind of a waste on the ads, we call it a truncated message. See more, no one's gonna click to see more. You should get everything that you need to say in, like, you know, 14, 18 words or less with a call to action and a picture or a video. One of the things also, and I see this a lot, again, people seem to think, like, they create an ad with the same kind of message they would send, like, their buddy or their homegirl about going to the club or what happened this weekend. And it's like, it's just not appropriate. If you're selling a car for $300,000 and you're running the ad, you better make sure that car is spelled right in that ad. Because if I have $300,000 and you can't spell the name of the car right, I'm not buying anything from you. Just my opinion. This is one of my favorites. I don't know if that's a sailboat or a fish in that photo. I don't know exactly what they're selling, except for that the name of the company is Costa Sunglasses, so I'm assuming they're selling sunglasses. But the copy is all wrong. There's no call to action. It doesn't tell you what they're selling. It doesn't give you a perceived benefit or feature or anything. It says midnight flight, full sail, photo, Oliver Rogers, and takes Bill Fish Foundation and some charter company. So again, it just looks like a wasted ad for a bunch of likes, and you know, I think they just kind of missed the target on this one. And this is one I see all the time: the car ad. Posting on social media or websites not the same thing. Again, you know, there's a difference between creating an ad and sending your buddy a text message. This is a text message my friend would send me if they saw a car that I was looking for sale. Nobody's gonna read all that. Not to mention there's still the truncated message. There's even more in there. I believe that people are lazy, that people aren't gonna read, that people want to have the text or the copy, whether it's on a website or on social media, they need to have it broken up, because as they're swooshing through their newsfeed, you only have maybe a tenth of a second to grab their attention and get that information out there. And again, this just doesn't do it. No punctuation. You know, some of the grammar just kind of messed up. And there's just too much text. So I really believe that this ad just kind of wasted some money. So what makes a good ad? Again, relevant, high-quality photos, videos. Make sure it's relevant and related to your subject matter. Minimal to no text, Facebook will take your money no matter what, but on your images, if you're putting, you know, all this text to make it look like a flyer, Facebook will still run it, but they're just not going to show it to as many people as if you had no text on there. So try to keep it minimal. They want it more visual and less spammy. Short, clear copy. You aren't selling the features in your products, all of your products that are on your website. You're selling this one specific item. You're selling this one specific product. And you're trying to get the person to click through and convert. Meaning, give the person just enough to get them interested in wanting more. So that when they decide to take that call to action, you know, learn more, shop now, book now. That's what you want them to do. You want these people from social media to go to your website to see what you offer, to see what you do, and keep coming back. And if you can do that and get their contact information, then you're in control of contacting these people and not at the mercy of Facebook whenever they feel like showing someone your post or your ads. Again, spelling and grammar, seriously, just, this is so important. I see this so much. Spelling and grammar go a long way. And if you don't know if you're spelling something correctly, there's this beautiful thing called Google, and I use it all the time. And you can literally write define and then put a word in there, and it will tell you if it's spelled properly or not. It takes a couple seconds. It'll save you a lot of heartache and headache. And there's these things on the internet called internet trolls and the grammar police, and they will go after you and start wasting your money while they're engaging with your ad, criticizing your spelling abilities. Call to action, just think about, what do you want people to do? You know, you want people to buy. Even something as simple as check this out. There's studies that say that if you actually tell your people or your audience what you want them to do, they're more likely to do it as opposed to not. So what do you got to lose, right? Define targeted audience. For example, if you sell chicken, okay, we had this conversation last night at dinner. If you sell chicken, you probably don't want your ads going to people that are vegetarian, right? Makes sense. Why are you wasting the money? And yes, you can seriously target these types of things with behaviors on Facebook. I can target people that are looking for cars, not even just cars, looking to buy sports cars that are used or new, that have a certain amount of income, that have kids in college, that work in certain places in certain industries. It's kind of creepy, but it's there and it's useful. And just a couple tips, top performing Facebook ads will have descriptions within 14 to 18 words. And remember that you only have about 1/10 of a second to grab somebody's attention. So make sure you're very clear, to the point, so that people respond to your ads and you just don't waste money. And then also, there was a study by Buzz Umo. They analyzed over 100 million Facebook updates over 3 months. And they found that Facebook posts with images received 2.3 times more engagement than those without. Facebook, Instagram photos with faces. So if you have an ad with a face in it, will have 38% more engagement than with those without. And I think it has something to do with people being able to relate to that picture. They see that person in themselves, and so they're more likely to engage. And a personal preference, don't use those 3D image guys that have no face. That is so spammy. It's bad. So I'm just going to show you how to do some quick targeting as an example, okay? So when you go into your ads manager and you go to create an ad, this is the first screen that you're going to see, and it's going to give you some options. So we're going to go through just to show traffic, right? So you can literally target any area, any behaviors, and if their presence is big enough, you could target the following of your competitors or possibly other racetracks, depending on how big that racetrack is. We reached out to a very big racing publication, and I don't know if our money just wasn't as green as everybody else's, but they wouldn't respond to us. So we took the next action and actually went and targeted all of their followers on social media and didn't give the company a dime. So, not gonna say who that was. So while you start to target some of these different audiences, if you see, like, we're actually targeting different locations. And you can now, you can target different cities, you can put, you know, how many mile radius, you can actually take like a pinpoint and drop it in there. So the other thing you can do, which will come up next, is that you can start targeting behavior. So one of the things that I think that people should do that they missed the boat on is actually sit back and think about what are the characteristics that make the perfect client of mine? What makes the perfect customer? What would these people like to do? What hobbies do they have? And so when you actually sit down and write this out and start building out this list, you can actually take those very same behaviors and hobbies and features and use them to build a Facebook ad. And you'll see in here. And you can also do languages and whatnot. So Summit Racing. My customers are going to buy from Summit Racing. My customers are going to buy from Jegs. My customers probably read Drag Illustrated. And wouldn't you know it, my customers probably watch Street Outlaws. Now you can target all that right in here. And again, you can also target people that Facebook sees that have behaviors that they're gonna buy cars, that they're in the market to buy a new car, whether it's a sport car or fuel efficient car, that they have school age children, they make a certain amount of money. If I was a large company looking to hire some new talent and I have some big competitors, I could create a job ad and start targeting the employees of my competitor companies to try to get their talent to leave that company and come into mine. It's kind of freaky. How does Facebook get this? Well, everything you have ever liked on social media, every post you have ever engaged with online, I mean, I've had a Facebook page for, 9 years. Can you imagine everything that you've liked over this period of time? So everything that you've done has been analyzed, cross-referenced, and social media, in my opinion, is nothing more than a huge bank of data. And you can now use that data to advertise and promote yourself, your business, or your brand. And one of the biggest mistakes that people make in not targeting, so when people are running ads, you're like, oh, well, you know, I threw this budget, I just ran this ad, and I had it go to everyone in Schaumburg, Illinois. Well, that's gonna go to everyone in Schaumburg, Illinois, not people that like racing, not people that are into motorsports, not people that are even looking for the services of your company. So why are you wasting money to promote to people that aren't your ideal customer? So to avoid all of this, wasted money and heartache and frustration, again, sit down and build what you think would be your ideal customer, what they like, what their interests are, what their hobbies are. You can also run multiple ads. Sometimes the same copy but different photos work better. I do this a lot. So I'll run multiple ads that may say the same thing, may say something different, and then as they start performing, I'll take the highest performing ads that people are engaging with, take that ad and dump more money in it so that it reaches more people because the other ads are underperforming. So A and B testing, test and tweak, and then make more informed decisions. Does that make sense? Is that good? Is that exciting? You guys ready to go run ads?
Yes.
Yes. Oh, thanks. Okay, so this is a little more advanced, but not so much. I thought it's worthwhile talking about Facebook pixels. Anyone ever heard of Facebook pixel? Yeah, a couple people? Okay. So Facebook pixel is even more creepy, but really exciting. So you can take this little snippet of code and you can put it on your website. You just put it right in the little head between the head tags. It's real simple. Facebook will walk you through it. So you put it on your website and it starts collecting data, right? And it continues to collect data. And what it's collecting is collecting information on the people that have visited your website. And so what you can do from that, you can do multiple things. One, when you start sending out ads, you can actually target the people that are visiting your website. Now, why would you want to do that? Well, because obviously these people have some kind of interest in your business, right? And it's kind of like what's called reminder marketing and multiple touch points. So somebody comes to RPEXPO, they see your booth, you're like, oh, look at, those are the Card Chicks. Oh, those are cool. I want to buy some from them. Then they never buy, right? So then they go home and maybe like a week or two later, they see your Facebook page. Oh yeah, those are those lunch chicks that I never bought anything from, but I thought about it. So then they still don't buy. But then all of a sudden, a couple weeks later, they're on Facebook and they get hit with an ad. Card Chicks is having a sale on their t-shirts or whatnot, and they're like, oh my God, those are the card chicks. I've been wanting to buy from them. They respond to the ad, they go to my website, they buy stuff, and they click purchase, enter their credit card number. Now I just had a converted customer. So we call that multiple touch points, reminder marketing. That's why a lot of people, even though I, you know, print advertising is kind of, it's hard to keep track of, it's hard to measure their return on investment. Unlike digital, digital's so cheap, you can watch in real time if it's working, but it's important to have multiple touch points to remind people about your company or your business. So with Facebook Pixel, that's what it's doing in one way, is to target people that have already expressed interest in your company. But there's another thing you can do with this pixel, and that's called build a look-alike audience. So what we were talking about, like, you know, trying to list all the characteristics of your ideal customer, Facebook will do this for you and call and create a look-alike audience, where now you can start targeting new people that haven't been to your website or haven't been to your business page, but these are the characteristics and the ideal customer that they see for you. So it's kind of interesting. Another thing you can do with the Pixel is that you can target people that watch your video. So I did this video, this unpacking video of the auto antlers, and I was like, look at these bad boys, they're great, right? And maybe I've had, you know, I don't know, 20 people like it, you know, maybe a couple dozen comments on it, but thousands of people watched it, right? And not everyone comments on stuff. Not everybody shares stuff. Not everyone interacts with stuff. But with the Facebook Pixel, anyone that watched that video, now I can send them my ad directly because they expressed some interest in it. The other thing you can do is you have an email list. I mean, that's ideally, this is what you want. Social media is a tool to get people to go to your website. And when you get them to go to your website, if you can get that email address, you're golden. Because that email address is going to allow you, again, to contact these people whenever you want to, and not when a social media network wants or lets you. And so once you start building up this email list, you can actually take this email list, upload it into Facebook, and they can either, one, start sending ads directly to those people in that email list, or two, build a lookalike audience of people to show the cross references and cross characteristics of these people. So it's a great tool. Google it. Facebook has like three steps on how you can get it set up, and it's definitely worthwhile. So what makes a post work? So NHRA posted this like a couple days ago, and it has all of the relevant features that make something work. It has a relevant photo or video. I mean, who doesn't like jet cars, you know, with the flames? Don't tell tough enough I said that. Hashtags, relevant hashtags that, you know, talk about the event that's coming up or that's related to, you know, what the post is about. It has a call to action, get your tickets at, with a link to your website. So why do people do this? Well, you want to drive traffic, you want to increase conversions. Ultimately, that's what you want people to do. You want people to convert. They want people to go to their website and buy tickets. You know, makes sense to me. And then also builds awareness and links. Google does have a little, when you're on social media and you're active on social media and you're continually posting, that does help play in some of the search engine results for Google. It gives you more authority for your website. If you have a website, you should have a website. And links. Every post that CardChix has ever made, for the most part, has a link going to the website, whether it's a goofy meme about, you know, racing, or it's an educational post or video. Just having the link there is always a great idea. So social media, it's not always about the likes. Let me show you what I mean. So this is a post that we did around this time last year. We simply cancel Valentine's Day and we make it race car day. It's one of our favorites. It had over 9,000 people like it. Okay, that's cool, right? 9,000 people. But it reached almost 350,000. So over 350,000 people saw this post, only 9,000 engaged with it. So again, that just goes to say, you know, it's not all about the likes. And not only is it not all about the likes on the actual post, because more people see and interact with it, but it's also not about all the likes on your actual page. Like, again, CardChix has over 100,000 people that like and follow our Facebook page. And everyone's like, oh, it's the greatest thing, you know? Well, I'm just going to go and buy some fake followers. That's the worst thing that you could possibly do. Because when you buy fake followers, first of all, you're putting your credit card number on a real shady website. You know, some chick's probably at Gucci, you know, or, you know, Louis Vuitton, buying herself a new purse with your credit card. And these people that come and like your page, they're not real people, they're robots, they're ghost followers. So they're never going to interact or engage with your page. They're never going to convert. They don't care about what you're selling. They don't care about your race team. They're never going to do anything for you. So it's better to have 1,000 real followers that are actually interested in what you're selling and what you're promoting, because they're actually going to convert one day when you ask them to. So it's not all about the followers or the likes. So Instagram, I love Instagram. You guys on Instagram? When you finally slide up into those DMs, you guys ever hear people say that? Or it's like, it's a real thing, and I'm gonna show you how this works. So one big thing that is going on now is influencer marketing. It's a really quick and inexpensive way, depending on who your influencer is, to get them to work with you. So this is what you want to do. So, you know, you search a keyword or hashtag that is relevant to your brand or to, you know, what you're trying to do. I use Card Chix in here. You know, obviously the top posts are us. You know, the top posts when you first do the keyword will be your influencers. They're the ones that have the most engagement on those, on their images. And so what you want to do when you want to work with an influencer, you want to look up the relevant keyword, look at their posts, look at their audience and their following, and say, does this match my following? Could this person help me? Because it's going to be cheaper to give them, you know, some money or free tickets to your event or racetrack to get them to share posts with their following than it is going to be to run an internet or a radio ad or maybe even a banner ad on one of the leading publications, and it's probably going to be more successful. So once you found that person and you've done some research, just send them a PM. All you gotta do is hit those three little dots up there, send them a message saying, hey, you know, I'd love to work with you. Hey, I'd like to give you some free tickets, you know, to this upcoming event if you share my photo. Or hey, you know, maybe we can do some kind of affiliate marketing thing so you can help me sell some rims for my company. So that's influencer marketing. So if you're a business, you really need to start looking at that, because right now, I mean, it's a new thing, it's underpriced, and it's very effective. Now, if you're a racer, on the flip side, you need to start considering having that into your sponsorship proposals. If you've got a big online presence and you're engaged with your audience, that's something that you can offer. So how do you build your followers on Instagram? Right now, Instagram is so like when Facebook first started, you used to be able to like people. Okay, like as a business page. You are no longer not able to do that. You have to be discovered. Well, Instagram, you can like people, and they can like you back. And so literally, you know, you go on your Instagram, search a keyword, and you can find your competitors. You can find like pages, like look-alike pages. Card Chix, we have a bunch of people that, you know, try to, you know, ride our coattails every now and then. So I could literally go to their page, go to their followers, and start following their people. And what happens is their people get an alert and say, oh my God, I have a new follower. I'm gonna go check out their page, and they're more likely to start following you back. And then to even increase the ratio of them following you back, like something on their page, talk to them. That's the biggest thing, is following and engaging with people. When someone goes and follows your Instagram account, talk to them. I don't wanna go on your page and talk to myself, you know, that's not fun. And then when other people see that you talk to them and engage with them, more people start to follow you. So beware of the fake pages. Again, just like Facebook, you don't want to follow fake people. You don't want them following you either, because it gives you a bad ratio. And don't become a robot. Like, don't sit there. And I tell you what, I did this a couple years ago. I would literally sit there and go, follow. But don't do that. It's such a huge mess. And then you have to go back over time and unfollow these people because they're fake pages. So be careful of that. So social media with the Instagram, it grows faster than Facebook, and before Facebook, you know, decides to, you know, put the kibosh on that, take advantage of it, because one day Facebook's going to say, all right, we're done with the freebies, kids. You guys want to grow your following? It's going to be pay to play, just like Facebook is now. The follow unfollow strategy, we just went through that. DMs, use it, check it. Businesses, work with influencers. Racers, be the influencer. And here's some more tips just to rehash this. Hashtags that are relevant to your brand. You know, the hashtags will help you be discovered and help you discover. Search phrases. I search, I need a website, like literally on Facebook every day to find people that posted that they need a website. And then I message them and say, hey, I'm Jeanette DesJardins and I am Crank It Media and I do websites, love to talk to you. And seriously, like, this is how this works. It's amazing. Social media, I always say it's, you know, play ball, work together. It is a big game of tennis. If you have a buddy that has another page, you guys will both grow so much faster and less expensive if you guys work together, meaning share for share. He likes your page, you like his page. He shares your post, you share his post. You guys just keep hitting the ball back together and you guys are gonna grow together. Your page will actually interact with people, or your page will actually grow faster if you interact with people on it. Don't wanna talk to myself, nobody else wants to talk to themselves. Don't be self-serving. Social media is not a megaphone for you to shove your services down people's throat. It's actually very annoying. Give people some value. Give them something to keep coming back for more, you know? So here are some free tools that I have used or used in the past. I run pages for over 2 dozen clients. I don't literally sit here and say, hey, you know, check out, I don't know, this race fire suit we just got in. I don't actually sit there and do that. What I do is I schedule it out because that's how I keep my sanity. And when you actually schedule it out, think about what you're going to write in advance. It all makes sense and becomes part of your strategy. Buffer and Hootsuite, they are free tools. And the analytics and insights that are free on every social media network, it's very useful. And you can't keep, you know, doing the same thing, expecting different results is just crazy. And so by making posts and then analyzing these posts, like literally looking at your data and seeing what responds better, and it's probably photo or video, you're able to tweak next week's posts. You're like, all right, well, it looks like people are engaging more with these types of posts, so let me do more of that. Makes sense, right? And then next week you analyze it again and keep on doing that. Google Analytics, I love Google Analytics. So say you have Google Analytics on a website, it's free, again, it's a little snippet of code, and I can see what people in the last 30 days have looked for the most on my website. And then I take that information and I make more posts about that on my website. I might even take, like say I'm a car dealership and I can see that the top 10 cars that these people looked at in the last 30 days, I'm gonna run ads on the first two. So that's what people are most interested in. They're more likely to, I'm more likely to get a conversion on running an ad that people are interested in, right? The repost app, that's for Instagram. A lot of people, you know, will tag you in different things on Instagram, but you can't share it because there's no feature, right? So you download repost app, and anytime someone, you know, tags you in something, you can just hit this little button, and bam, you like just reshare the post. It takes all their tags, it retags them and everything. It definitely grows your following. And not to be a smart ass, but Google, seriously, I could sit up here for days talking about all these free tools and tips. All you gotta do is Google it, man. You can Google it. There's like thousands and thousands of websites and free information out there just at your fingertips. And here's some great resources that, you know, I use to try to keep up with, you know, the new trending stuff, the changes in algorithms, the new tools that are coming out. Obviously, Cranky Media, that's my company, so I'm a little biased about that, but great company, great website. Social Media Examiner, there's an HubSpot Resource Center, Hootsuite Resource Blog, Buffer Resource Blog. These four are popping out so much content every day, it's hard to keep up with different strategies, different tips, how you can do things better. And these are the HubSpot, Hootsuite, and Buffer. They actually offer a free tool to help you do social media better. So now they're coming up with articles and tips because they want you to use their tools the best that you can. You know, so the more successful you are, the more successful they are. So check out these free tools. You know, again, Facebook groups. Just remember, you can't do this alone. Like, yeah, I went to college, you know, at University of Wisconsin, but at the time I went to business school, they didn't talk about social media. They thought social media was a fad. I went up there and I gave a presentation about how I was going to use social media to sell cars. My teacher thought I was crazy, you know? I'd love to go talk to her now. She actually was a reference for my first job, which was kind of funny. But again, you can't do this alone. So the Facebook groups, there's lots of free ones out there where people that are marketers or whatnot and trying to figure out the best way to approach or sell something. And yeah, maybe you guys are all selling different things, but the strategies are the same. You know, the concepts are the same. Whether you're selling an Eskimo snow or, you know, some guy a Cadillac, really the strategy is still kind of the same. You know, you start following key influencers. One of my favorite people to follow is Gary Vee. Gary Vee is a man. He's very, a huge marketer. He, grew his business from the ground up, came from a very poor family. Now he has like the leading marketing company in the world. And he also provides a lot of free content, a lot of motivation. And so, there's literally thousands of free resources at your fingertips. Stop scrolling through the Facebook news feed. Stop looking at cute cat photos and start using that Google search box. The world is at your fingertips, literally. Seriously. So websites. Who here doesn't have a website? You guys all have a website? Phil, come on, man. Are you serious? All right, so Phil doesn't have a website. So we're going to talk about things that Bill is missing out on. So these are some examples of websites. There's all different kinds out there. So websites. Why? Okay, why? Literally, why? Why do you need a website? Well, you want to be discovered. Obviously, you want to share important information. Added value for you and your potential sponsors. Is anyone a racer in here? Is anyone driving? There you go. So when you go and approach sponsors, it's like, well, you know, what are all the benefits and features I'm going to get out of the sponsorship? You know, I'm sure they ask you, you know, hey, do you have a website? What's your following like? These are all questions that they probably didn't ask like 6-7 years ago. You know, maybe they asked about the website, but they didn't care about your followers. Now that's one of the first questions they ask. So by, adding value for you and your potential sponsors, you know, you can put your sponsorship or your sponsor's logo up there, the information up there. You can tag them in it, which sponsors love. Other businesses love being tagged and linked to. Have a store. Literally make money while you sleep. And I know as a racer, it's hard to, you're always looking for money to go to the next event to fix the car you just blew up or crashed or, you know, get a new set of tires. And, by having that online store up there, yeah, you know, maybe you'll sell like, you know, a couple t-shirts a month or maybe you'll sell like thousands of, you know, t-shirts a month. But by not having that up there, you just don't know, you know? So a lot of people will also say, Jeanette, I don't need a website, I got a Facebook page. And I'm like, you gotta be kidding me, man. Like, you know, how much do I have to beat this into you? Social media is a marketing platform, okay? You should be using the social media to drive traffic to your website. And then once you have that traffic on your website, you use that to gain business or to gain authority or, customers. And if you can, again, get the email addresses. That way you can contact them whenever you want. The website is more of like your professional image. The social media is more of like happy hour without the alcohol. You know, it's a little more personal or whatnot. So you have static information. Again, on your website, you're in control of that information. On Facebook, Facebook's in control. Like a lot of people aren't gonna see your post or what you're doing. So you need to have that website. And again, not everyone has Facebook. My grandpa doesn't have Facebook. Bill doesn't have Facebook. He doesn't have a website either. Bill, we're going to have to work with you, man. And again, who do you want driving the bus? You know, do you want Facebook driving the bus for you, or do you want to drive your own bus and be in control of your own information and your own destiny? So websites, the winning websites, all have the same key features. They have the contact info and the contact forms, you know. They have the contact info right on top, right on your top hand, right-hand side, on this side. They'll have the contact form on the right-hand side. They'll have news, blog, and articles just to, you know, keep creating content. Again, just had this conversation last night. People will stop following websites when they go to them. They don't see anything change. And even if you are adding content, they just can't visually see it. Because they don't want to scroll down, they will stop going to your website because they think that you don't update it. So by having a couple things like, say, a slider, where when you share a new post or a photo, it automatically uploads that on there. So even if, you know, it's not like a huge change in information, to the person coming to your website, mentally, they see a change, and so then they start searching more and spending more time on it. And then also by creating the news, blog, and articles, you're creating more content for your website. Google creates more links to get people to go to your website and more things for them to search. Obviously, social media integration, you know, not only to follow us on these networks, but to have on the bottom of your, on the bottom or top of your articles, to have social media share buttons. Because people are like, wow, it's a fascinating article. You know, that young lady, she was like the fastest woman at the race that weekend. And she's just lovely. I'm going to share this because I want all my followers to see that. And that's how you start gaining more people. Mobile friendly and responsive, that is huge. Google, if your website is not mobile friendly, if it is not designed for the fingers like this, they are actually giving you negative points and showing up for the search results. So your website is not where it should be in search results. You're actually getting pinged to go down, which is bad. So they're not playing games anymore. Mobile has surpassed desktop a long time ago. So it's time to get on board with that. And above the fold, again, when you go to a website, you want to have all the important information right there without scrolling down, because people are lazy. They're not going to scroll down unless they absolutely have to, or they're bored, or they're like me, and I'm just analyzing everything on your website. Search engine optimization. There's a lot of, like, one of the new things now, and again, I do websites for people, is getting them on board with, like, WordPress. Because WordPress, it does it all for you. It's mobile friendly, it's responsive. It, like, the search engines love it. It, like, tweaks your content and your data. It's very easy to use, and like once you get it designed that way, it's turnkey. I can give it to you. If you know how to use a Word doc, you can update your website. So like these old school coders, the HTML guys, they hate me, and they hate people that have WordPress because they're probably losing out on money. Sorry, guys. So websites, first steps. Jeanette, Bill's gonna come to me tomorrow. He's like, Jeanette, I want a website. What do I do? All right. First of all, Bill, you're gonna have to research your name across all the platforms. Okay, you want to make sure that you know your website and your social media names are all the same. You also want to make sure that your name is available. So you know you want billsphotoandvideos.com. So Bill's going to go on GoDaddy and say, "Ooh, I want to see if that's available." Go on there, and he's going to see that's available and buy it. Or he's going to see that it's not available, and he has to be like, "Bill's Photos and Videos, you know, 0.2.016." I mean, like that's not a good website. So you need to research those names to make sure it's good. So now you want to buy your domain, which is billsphotosandvideos.com. Again, you go on GoDaddy, most websites, you can buy the domain for $7.99. $7.99, and you will have your own website domain. Even if you are not ready to create a website at this point, at least buy your domain name so no one else can buy it from you. Figure out your website style. A lot of people are like, well, I don't know what to do with my website. The best thing that you can do is to go to different websites that you like of your different, you know, competitors or your favorite race teams, and that way you can start to see what styles you like and what you don't like, and that will save you a lot of time, and it will save people designing your website a lot of time. And again, have a reputable company build your site or build your own. There are, if you have the time, there are a lot of different tools out there that can help you build your own website, like GoDaddy. Not only can you buy a domain there, you can you know, if you have the time, you can design your own website on there. It might not be, you know, the prettiest thing, but it'll work. Google domains. You can buy domains from Google. Some of them are like, I think, $1.99, you know. You want to, in my opinion, you always want to be friends with Google, because Google is the largest search engine in the world. So the more products you buy from them, I think the more favorable they are to you. The Google Keyword Planner. That's a great free tool to see what people are searching for the most. What keywords should I be using in my content, in my website name? And WordPress. I already talked about WordPress. I love WordPress. And just great tools. So creating content. A lot of people are like, this is like the hardest thing for them is to create content. And sometimes it's hard for me too. I tell you what, there's days I wake up and I can write for 14 hours straight, and then I can't write anything for 2 weeks because I have like writer's block. So when the getting's good, start writing. And you can write, you know, blog posts. A lot of blog posts that do well are things like top five reasons to, or how to do this, some kind of educational white paper type deal. Video is so huge, you can't get enough of video. Everyone's got this. You have no excuse not to be taking videos and photos of what you guys are doing, of your business, the behind the scenes, your race weekend. You know, relevant photos, what's trending. You can literally Google what's trending and then write something about it. Be careful, because sometimes what's trending might not be appropriate to write for. You know, sometimes we have bad events happen across the United States that are trending. You probably don't want to associate a blog post with that. It'll come back to bite you. Talk about what you know and what you're passionate about, because that's what you're going to be good at. And build a content folder. So that's what I was saying about if you can write all day, you're in the right mood, just start saving stuff. Write different articles. Put them in a folder. Don't publish them all at once. Scale them out. Like, publish something once a week. Publish something twice a week. Here's a list of different content formats that you can, just to give you like an idea. And you, again, you can Google this. You can Google this and start getting some ideas flowing. You know, how-tos, case studies, cartoons, tool reviews, giveaways, frequently asked questions. I mean, these are all different things to give you an idea on like, what can I possibly write about to start creating content, whether it's on your social media or it's on your website. So beware, sponsors, fans, and consumers will research you. They already are. They're probably doing it right now. They look at your website. They look at your social media presence. They look at all of your online presence. And even at events like this. Who went out last night? Anyone close any bars last night? Because I know a couple people did. They look a little rough downstairs right now. Look at the kid in the bed. They look a little rough right now. So now you might have a potential sponsor here that's, you know, like, oh, well, this guy, you know, he sent me a proposal. Well, let's just see how he presents himself at these different events, because you are going to be the face of their business. You know, and if you're down there, you know, you barely stand straight, and you're all flushed, you have the red skin, you're sweating, man, you know, and you're not looking too good, they don't want that to represent their business, you know. You know, the same thing outside of, like, I watch what I post on my personal page. Even though I don't use my personal page for business, I have over 5,000 people that follow me on my personal page. So I try not to, you know, I don't know, I put a picture of my dog on there, and sometimes it upsets people, you know. So you just have to, you know, again, the magnifying glass effect. Someone's always looking, someone's always analyzing, and people are always judging. And just be careful. I mean, it's springtime. What does your online presence say about you? Maybe it's time to clean some of that stuff up. You guys got any questions? Anything? Anything? Nothing? Terrified? No questions?
What about surveys?
Can I mention that? So I actually helped Mr. Zerk here with the survey for his business, and they say with the surveys, if you offer you know, some kind of incentive, like a reward or something, we did a $5 gift card to Starbucks. Depending on what you get, you might be able to get a half of a coffee, but whatnot. But we, by offering that $5 gift card, you got, what is it, like almost 50%?
Over a third.
Yeah, over a third of people actually responded to a survey, and we did it in real time. We did it using, again, Google has so many free tools out there. We did it using Google Forms. So we created a really easy mobile-friendly survey, and people went on there and they filled it out, and the data that started populating in real time was like amazing. And so you learn so much about like your demographics and the audience that you're trying to sell to, that I think that you're probably going to use some of that information and maybe tweak or approach things a little differently. It also probably gave, you know, you and your partner some confidence that you guys are right on track, right?
Right. I think the important thing goes with the way we sorted, we broke it into individual pieces we wanted. We created the questions. Mm-hmm. We're selling homes in Lake Geneva, so
right.
Who's going to buy a home in 6 months? Who's going to buy a home in 2 years? I don't need to talk to the guy who's going to build a home in 2 years. So we ask the questions, when are you going to buy? People
right.
Don't want to give you, they come to your VIP list, they don't want to give you your address. You offer them a $5 discount, but I got mail somewhere, then they give you their address, so that helps
right.
You.
Right. Their social security numbers, the birthdates of their children. Why don't I get a $5 gift card to Starbucks? What do you need? You know?
So the beauty of it was, now we know where the biggest populace of people come, and it helps you fill in, do we want a geo-grid or targeted area? Mm-hmm. Maybe we know where the best areas to target are, and
right.
Where areas aren't worth targeting, so does it make any sense to put an ad out there and target an area that, you know, are these?
Sure.
So it was.
And you ended up getting all those people's email addresses too, so now, even, and Rick here, actually, you have been running some ads. Now you can actually take that email address and make a lookalike audience, or try some of this Facebook pixel stuff and you know, see where it goes from there. So anyone buying a house in Lake Geneva, talk to Rick back there. Yes, sir?
Yeah, Another thing is when you go to hotels, you buy Amazons or anything, there's reviews. You look at people's remarks of the product, of the good, the bads of it.
I do all the time.
Okay. The thing is I've done searches. A lot of them are bots.
Right.
How do you know which is true and not?
Well, I always look at the worst ones first and say, well, if that experience happened to me, could I deal with that? And then that's how I make my purchase decision.
Yeah.
But that's just me. But no, definitely on Amazon, there's definitely some bots. And I think, like, you know, you just have to, like, you know, weed that out on your own. But there's certain things that you can see, like when robots post.
What I notice is one of these had a lot of bad responses.
Mm-hmm.
But it was a product I'm looking for.
Okay.
But how they got me was because I'm... Why is there so much response, bad response? I called them. They get my name.
Okay.
And I says, your product's good, but why have you got so bad reviews? Says, it's people that just don't, I don't know. They didn't even, a couple of them told me, says, I gave them the names.
Sure.
They didn't even buy anything from us.
Sure. Well, Amazon has that verified purchase review on there, too. So have you ever noticed if you're looking at Amazon, some of the reviews on there will say this is confirmed to purchase? You know, some people, they just have nothing better to do. Chix, I'm actually kind of surprised. With over 101,000 followers on our Facebook, we don't get trolled more than we actually do. Every now and then we get some guy in there that just, he's having a bad day, he's got nothing better to do, or it might be some 12-year-old kid that lives in his mom's basement. I have no idea. You know, so I just kind of, you know, we just don't... We don't add fuel to the fire or feed the monster. But with, you know, with some of the reviews, the fake ones, you can tell a lot of times if it's a robot by how the grammar's used, how the punctuation is, you know? And so that's why I tell a lot of these guys, like, that are selling products that don't spell check or whatnot, it's like, you know, you kind of come across as a scam because that's what people are starting to recognize as a pattern. So, anybody else?
Is it something good to add to your... I mean, like...
Reviews?
Reviews.
I think reviews are nice because you're showing that you're a transparent person, but just be prepared. There's going to be good and bad reviews.
Yes.
And then you will be criticized if you actually remove the bad reviews because people pay attention to stuff like that, you know? So just be prepared to take the good with the bad, you know? And I think that you're, by being transparent like that, I'm more likely to do business with you,
right.
You know? So it is what it is, and also be prepared. I mean, I have some friends that, you know, they had disgruntled employees, and they, you know, former employees, they left some really horrible things. But you can, I think, like, as a consumer, I can kind of see through some of that,
right.
You know, just based on what they write or what they say. And I also think it's good to respond to sometimes, depending on what it is, and don't have an attitude with the people that are asking questions. Like, answer their question. And you can also, like, take that as a learning experience. Like, say you have a car ad, and these people are asking all the same questions. Now, could you have made your car ad better? Are you missing information on your website? Because you could just say, this information is posted on my website, here's the link. But if it's not there, this is what's eating up all of your time. So maybe, like, reverse engineer, why are these people asking this to figure out what you're missing on, you know, your end? So, Blake?
I answered my own question.
You answered your own question. Okay.
But I think it is. I think it is still important. And it kind of went off of his review thing, and it, not really necessarily to do with ads, but just in Facebook in general. I'm sure all of us kind of face this problem. I know that we do as a racetrack.
Mm-hmm.
We might post something out on Facebook, and of course we have our outsider trolls.
Right.
And you know when there's people that defend us, and there's people that add on to it, but. Is there a way to kind of, I guess, legitimately control that? I mean,
no.
Everyone's has their own opinion, and when you ask somebody a question, you're forcing them to make a decision if they see that post, and if their opinion is one thing, even if you don't care what it is.
Right. Well, I think with social media, is funny because people, I have seen some grown men. Like grown, big, tough guy men on Facebook looking like an episode of Mean Girls with Lindsay Lohan, you know? And it can really bring out the ugly in somebody if without them realizing it. And I think what happens is people, they find a way to release some kind of stress or some kind of anger, and they do it on their keyboard without realizing that there are some consequences. Not thinking of who's going to see that, not thinking of what it, you know, I'm always like, you know, who cares what people think, but, you know, what are people going to think about that? You know, I don't think people really hash out this this process in their head before they do it. And so I think that when people go and troll other pages, they already have this, they have already made up their mind about what they think about you and their opinion of you, just like some people in real life that have never met you. And so why waste the energy on that? You know, the beautiful thing on Facebook, there's this thing called block, you know? And if someone really gets out of hand, just block them, you know? I mean, fortunately, we've only had to block a handful of people, you know? But
we've done the same thing.
Yeah. That's only if they totally get out of hand. Otherwise, they're just, you know, whatever, let it be. You know, don't feed the troll, you know?
And it's winter.
That's
the worst part, yeah. Idle hands.
Racers are the worst in the winter. Someone take those keyboards away from them, you know? So.
That's nice to know.
Sorry. I love you guys. So we have another seminar coming in. Does anyone else want to ask anything real quick? Okay, otherwise I have the booth at Card Chix, right by Racing Junk and NMCA NMRA. You guys come on down and talk to me anytime. And I hope you guys have a great show, and thanks for spending your Sunday morning with me.